Thank you, Ranjan ma'am. One young boy comes to his mother and says, "Mom, find me a perfect girl to marry." The mother gives a perfect advice. Be a perfect man. The perfect girl will follow for you. So, with these words, when we see Justice Roshan Gulli here, we know she always in Bombay High Court gave the perfect advice. She was admired by many. It was like she was the RM lady of the Bombay High Court. May I request an Asha of ma'am to give this speech, introduction about this resume.
Hello friends, on today's auspicious day of Women's Day, I take pleasure in introduction of chief guest, who in fact need no introduction. We all are in High Court many times and we have seen both the ladies. Today our chief guest, both of them are legal luminaries. However, as a formality, I take pride in introducing them today. Our first speaker today is Madam Roshan Gulli, retired judge, High Court, Bombay High Court. Ma'am, everyone of us know you very well. Scholar having brilliant career, ma'am, born in 53. She completing BCom in 73 with specialization in business management and LLM in 78 from University of Bombay. Madam, you were appointed fellow of Government Law College and awarded merit scholarship of University of Bombay in LLM. Original sat Council of Bombay High Court from August 76 to September 89. In civil and corporate matters, visiting faculty at Jamnalal Bajaj Institute of Management Studies and Narasimha Munji Institute of Management Studies for Corporate Law between 79 and 89. She was appointed as Judge Bombay City Civil and Sessions Court in September 89. She had presided over civil and criminal matters, Special Court CBI and Special Court MPID for anti-corruption and investor fraud cases. Ma'am, before you were elevated as judge to Bombay High Court bench in June 2005, you served as principal judge, Family Court, Mumbai from July 2004 to December 2004. You were selected to participate in the judicial training program in gender and law at the University of Warwick, Coventry, UK, meant for Indian judicial officers under Indo-British Judicial Sensitization Program, conducted by the British Council with National Judicial Academy, and has since been a member of the Association of British Scholars, ABS, Mumbai chapter, for undertaking various socio-legal programs. She had conducted workshops, colloquia at resource person, as resource person trainer for judges and lawyers on gender laws, court and cases management and alternative dispute resolutions. Ma'am was appointed as judge of Special Court Trial of Offences relating to Transaction and Securities Act 1992 with effect from 1911-2012, and ma'am retired with her spacious experience on 6 November 2015 from Bombay High Court. And madam, we are all eager to hear you on this auspicious day devoted for women in the world. Please ma'am, take over the podium.
There was a woman who had two children. She was highly qualified. She could not take up any job. She lived at home. She took care of the children. And the children grew. When they were about 10 and 12, they did not want the mother all the time. So the lady thinks that now is the time that she will take up a job and make a career. She applied for a job. She had to fill up a form. And there was a column of experience. So she wrote nil because she had no experience in any job. She was not selected. She tried finding out why she was not selected. And she reasoned that it was because she had no experience. She again applied in another company to fill up such a form. And then in the column of experience, she wrote 12 years experience in human resources. She got the job. She did very well. This is generally what happens around the world. I have been a judge for 26 years. I have been a lawyer for 40 years. When I was a young student and a young lawyer, I used to conduct paralegal training. At that time, we used to shout for women's rights, equal rights, you know, we want, etc. Now we don't have to do that. All the people in our strata of society have come of age. All girls go to school, colleges, universities, and do get equal rights. There is a large section in our country who are not as lucky as we are. They are not empowered. It is for them that we have to work. And it is for them that people like Ranjan do social service. And I would like to do, and I feel very satisfied. So often, in my judicial career, I realize the great disparity between some women who have, as we say, come of age, got everything, demanded everything. The law gives them everything, the court gives them everything. They even abuse the law at times, and need to put them in jail. But there are so many women who don't even know how to access justice. These are the women who, in our justice system also, should be empowered. I realized when I did testamentary work and I did family law work that actually the women do have equal rights when it comes to family law. But in the testamentary jurisdiction, when they become widows, they almost have no rights and they can exercise none. The law gives them all the rights, but the position in which they are, they do not and cannot exercise it. I'll give you two examples. One as a lawyer and one as a judge. And I would leave to you to feel as to where we should begin and where perhaps we should end. Because empowerment doesn't mean only aggression. It means negotiating spaces and getting the best deal out of any situation. When I was a lawyer, I had one case of a woman who had become a widow. Her husband had died prematurely. She came from a very wealthy family. It was an HUF. The father and three sons were in business. They had a large plant. Everything was hunky-dory. The women of the household, that means the wives of these three brothers, were all well-kept. They had their children, they were living together. Very healthy, happy family life. Suddenly one brother expired. Now this wife said, I'm not getting anything, and that's how she came to us. So the solicitor wanted me to draft a claim, and we had to file a suit for administration of the estate of her deceased husband. He told her that she has got a right to 1/4 of his estate, along with her mother-in-law and her two children. Because under Section 8 of the Hindu Succession Act, the mother, the wife and the children share equally, which is a very, very noble position. And she told us about the plant and the business, etc., but not about the husband's properties. So we said, we will have to give a notice and then file the suit if they don't give you anything. So you get all these particulars and we need out a whole list. Because unless she got the particulars, we can't put the schedule to the plaint and we can't ask for administration. After 15 days when I had kept the conference, the lady came back to me and said that she does not want to sue. She said, stop everything. I don't want it. And I, being what I was at that time, I think about 28, 29 years ago, I said, no, you've got the right and you've got to get it, etc. And the law gives you and how should you say no? She tells me, I'm living in a large HUF family flat. These people have not ill-treated me. They have ignored me. I of course don't have 1/4 of my husband's estate, but I don't even know what it is. To know, I have to give them notice. To do that, I will have to give it from their own flat. And the notice will be addressed in the same flat. I will not be able to live in this flat. My children then will not be able to live in this flat. Either I will have to walk out first without my children or with my children. I have no place to go. In my house, my brother has married. He's got a wife. He's got children. There's no place for me. Here I am a widow. am not having much, but my children are having a lot. My children are treated well as grandchildren. They are with their cousins. They are growing up, and here what education they will get, I'll be able to provide. In this scenario, I don't want my rights. I will wait for my children's rights to come. And I learned a lot which I have not forgotten till today. This is the discretion, the sagacity, and the wisdom of a woman. So when we talk of women empowerment, it's not only fighting. It is getting the best and negotiating the best places. Now when we see the other side of the world, consider the same family. The three brothers are in business. They have large contracts. They've got a plant to run. They have made a deal with somebody. That man becomes bankrupt. That company may become bankrupt. They may be just dishonest people and not supply goods. What will they do? They will not only fight the litigation. They will settle so that they can get something and go into business again. They say, forget 50 lakhs, we'll make 50 crores elsewhere. They also negotiate their spaces. They also get empowerment in this. And everything is for consideration. So the point that I'm trying to make is that yes, we have to fight for those who don't have. But we must know where to stop also. We must know how to go about it also. That takes experience learning, and it also takes a good deal of understanding of life otherwise. When we talk of ADR, we mean this. You see, there was a very interesting case in ADR, the mediation, the alternative dispute resolution, where a firm could not supply goods. The other firm, to whom goods had to be supplied, gave that same firm some finance so that they could buy, so that they could supply goods. And made a contract that whatever you earn, 75% is ours, 25% is yours. Go on in your business. In 3 years, they were paid off. If they had come to court, for 30 years, they would not be paid off. Similar analogy applies in the families, applies for women. And when you empower them, you have to empower them, taking into account various such factors. I'll give you one more example. Also of a widow. She became a widow, and after the 12th day ceremony of her husband's funeral, etc., she was not allowed to enter the house. She had gone to her mother's house, and she remained there. She didn't have much place to stay, so she didn't take her daughter. The in-laws, that is the husband's mother and father, moved into this husband's house and stayed put. The daughter they kept. They must have indoctrinated the daughter so much that the daughter hated the mother. This also was in my testamentary jurisdiction. I had called the mother and daughter in my chamber. The daughter didn't want to talk to the mother. What they said was, and this was an application for grant of letters of administration by this lady who didn't have anything for about two and a half years. They first said that it was long delayed. But this kind of matters are always long delayed because they wait and wait for the family to give in and then they come to court. The second was they said, this mother is so bad, she took away the GPF, the Provident Fund, of my father and didn't give me. So she is not fit enough. What I realized from the evidence was that these people have come into the flat, not allowed her to come in. She was the nominee in the GPF. So the company gave her the GPF, because she was the nominee. Of course she didn't give it to them, but she didn't get anything in the flat and in any other estate. So she kept the GPF. And if I were to give anything, I would tell her to give 2/3 of the GPF back. Because her mother-in-law, her daughter, and she would share equally. There was no scope and she kept it. Now this daughter tells me that my mother didn't do anything for me. But a judge must hear what people cannot speak and listen to what they cannot talk. Why would this mother not come into the house? Why would the mother-in-law and father-in-law live in this house? Evidence showed that they had another house. Evidence showed that the husband, wife and child lived in this house. What they tried to tell me was that she was a bad mother and never did anything for me. This was because the girl was indoctrinated. The father had died when she was 6 years old. Very impressionable age. She got impressed by her grandparents who lived with her, who treated her well. She was going to college when she came to meet me. But the mother, she didn't talk to her. Now, if the mother was really as bad as she said, why would she have continued to be the nominee of the Provident Fund? The husband would have made another nomination. He didn't do that. Why would the second flat be in the name of the husband and the wife? Because they were living as a nuclear family. If she was bad, as I was told from much before he died, the husband would have gone with the daughter to his parents' house. He would not have had a separate flat. I refused to believe that story. I gave her administration of the estate. I don't know how she would have been able to administer the estate which I allowed. These are the women who then must be empowered. People like us must give them a helping hand to get their dream. I don't want to take up too much time because I want to hear the speakers. I think it would be nice to give you an illustrations rather than only a lecture. So I'll give you two glaring illustrations. But when a woman comes up, when she is given a chance, she proves it.